Okay.
Right. I think we'll get started, yeah?
Yep.
Okay, so good evening to everybody to this Zoom webinar for the Trace House of Glasgow annual lecture. And it gives me great pleasure to say to you that we have asked and invited City of Glasgow College to take part in this lecture this evening for the first time. So the college will now become part of what we call the circuit of institutions who will take turnabout to make this lecture annually. And they include Glasgow University, University of Strathclyde, and Caledonian University. So a warm welcome to the college. And in that connection, I would like to introduce you, first of all, to Paul Little, who has been principal and chief executive of City of Glasgow College since 2010. And during this time has grown the organisation and new campus to world-class status, as underpinned by the number one ranking from WorldSkills UK. Paul is also president this year of Glasgow Chamber of Commerce, and not busy enough, he's also chair at EFQM, the respected Quality Foundation. So a very, very warm welcome, Paul, to you. And I know that you are going to introduce tonight's speaker, who is Gary Maclean. Over to you, Paul.
Thank you very much, Deacon Campaigner. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm truly delighted to be here tonight to support and introduce Gary. He doesn't need much support from me, just needs a formal introduction. I'm also a member of the Trades House myself, a proud bonnet maker, and I regularly attend your dinner. And in that guise, I've met some fantastic Deacon Conveners. But one of the more visionary ones of them was actually Deacon Convener Ken Dalglish, who some of his predecessors talked about getting this as a Trades House lecture, and Ken made it happen. So it's a great honour for City of Glasgow College to be here tonight as Scotland's super college with some 30,000 students. And to have one of those distinguished students speak to you tonight, Gary Maclean. Now, Gary has known to many of you, but some of what I might say might not be known. And certainly by the end of tonight, you will learn much more about Gary the person and not just Gary the celebrity. So he's our executive chef at the City of Glasgow College, and he started his own learner journey about the same time as Scotland entered its very first European tournament. That was way back in 1998. Gary is that young, ladies and gentlemen. And we're going to continue to go for success, and tonight will be the talisman for that success, because Gary has definitely got a Midas touch. And, you know, Gary, when he was learning as a student, was also working part-time. And in that time, he developed his culinary arts. And to be honest, there are very few people that I know that Gary hasn't cooked for. He's cooked for royalty. He's cooked for global pop stars. He's cooked, and he'll obviously tell you about some of those. He's cooked for government officials. And when the First Minister tours, she's also his executive chef. But Gary has put all that down in his recent book, The Joy of Home Cooking, and no doubt he will mention that during his talk. But very distinguished career, and he's helped launch 80, that's 80 restaurants across Scotland and beyond, including his own in Edinburgh. Perhaps most of you will know that this home son came to great fame as MasterChef the Professional in 2016. He took on 47 other professional chefs, and he was the first ever educator chef, as well as a professional chef, in his own right to appear and battle his way through a year-long competition to win the hearts and minds of the judges and indeed the viewers. And he's since continued winning hearts and minds as Scotland's national chef, and he's done this great nation proud across the world in showcasing the great larder that we have here in Scotland. And I guess you won't know, but Gary has helped City of Glasgow College across the world. And in the past year alone, he's had over 1 million viewers in the various webinars and seminars that he's done on behalf of the City of Glasgow College and indeed in promoting our work as a college in America. Gary's also our account director for the Americas, US and Canada. I guess of all the accolades that Gary has, the one that always amazes me and impresses me the most is Gary is very much a very genuine family man. And although he's out tonight entertaining us and educating us, Gary is, the father of five lovely children and the devoted husband of wife Sharon. So normally of a Monday night, Gary is extremely busy cooking for the entire week. So the family doesn't starve while he's out entertaining all those celebrities and educating us tonight. So ladies and gentlemen, sit back and enjoy what I think will be your greatest ever lecture. Gary Maclean, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks very much, Paul. That was quite an introduction, and you're setting me up here, the greatest ever lecture. I know this night is always a good one, and it's a real privilege to be here. I'd like to thank Ken, the Deacon Convener, for inviting the City of Glasgow College and myself along. It is a real privilege being a very, very proud Glaswegian to be able to speak to you tonight. We're going to attempt some technology. I'm going to let the BBC introduce me. I don't know if that'll be better than Paul. I doubt it, but I thought it would be good fun. So if you can bear with me, I will get my video going. Give me 30 seconds. Right. We will get there. So this is my first time ever doing this. We will share with sound. We will share that.
I've been a chef for well over 20 years. And the one thing I can say is, I know talent when I see it in the kitchen.
Professionalism is almost an understatement. You surpass that. We've come a long way together, but the journey is about to come to an end. Professional Master Chef winner is Gary.
Amazing. I've loved every single working with you, you know. I've loved it.
So many experiences, so many wonderful people met. The whole thing has just been once in a lifetime. So I look back on it with fond memories and lots of excitement, I really will.
I'm overwhelmed with everything at the moment. You know, you've made friends for life now, so, you know, I'm happy. I'm very happy for Gary as well. The best chef won, and he absolutely deserved to win.
Yes. Incredible. What an amazing journey. This is the biggest competition I think any chef can put themselves through, and to be standing here at the end is incredible. I've just ran out of words, to be honest.
Well deserved.
Thank you.
There you go.
Incredible.
There you are.
Well, congratulations.
Done. Thank you.
Cheers.
Cheers, everybody. Well done. Well done, guys. Congratulations. Champion. Gary has soaked up every little bit of this competition. He lived the MasterChef dream. He's a major talent, he's grown incredibly well, and he's a gentleman of the kitchen.
That man has forged his own style of cookery while he's been here on MasterChef. It's modern, it's of the moment, and I think it's fantastic.
I've hit emotions that I never knew I had, all in, you know, 30 seconds of each other. Words can't describe it. Never ever thought I would win, never. My wife and kids are going to go nuts. They're absolutely going to go nuts.
There, we managed it. Just a quick story. I'm going to go to the end first, unexpectedly. I thought it'd be quite novel. So all of that was filmed during the summer holidays. So most folk didn't know I was doing it. And then I won. And I thought to myself, this was August 2016, and it was going to be shown on the TVs in November. And I thought to myself, do you know what? I'm going to have to speak to Paul. And much as Paul and I had done a lot of things together, it was very, very unexpected that I would email him personally and ask for a meeting. And it took me about 3 weeks to get the meeting because I wouldn't tell the chief of staff what the meeting was about. I just kept, because I was sworn to secrecy, I had a BBC contract that was about 40 pages long, but I couldn't tell anyone. And so I eventually got in front of Paul and said, look, trust me, it's good news, but it's something Paul definitely needs to know. So went up to the office, brand new college. We'd just opened the new campus at City, and was in, you know, beautiful office. I got a nice cup of tea brought through. And I says to Paul, I says, look, we've got this juggernaut coming. I've spent the summer competing on MasterChef, the professionals. And Paul said, I'm really sorry, I don't have a TV, so I don't know what that is. So we then had to get Claire in to explain. So she added the much needed excitement for that meeting. But it's been quite a journey since then. But I'm going to go back. I'm going to go back to my beginnings, if you don't mind. And basically what I wanted to do with this chat is just to talk about young people from you know, a tough background who can achieve stuff. And I know a lot of people on this call already know that, but I just wanted to talk about, you know, what a wee bit of ambition and a lot of support can do for a young person. So I'm going to get back to the start of my journey, and hopefully you find it interesting. Again, it's certainly going to be different from any other lecture I think that's been here. But it's just a story of drive and determination and I think understanding yourself a wee bit. So I'm going to start in Glasgow in the 70s and 80s. Growing up in Glasgow was tough. I lived in the wrong side of Knightswood, as we would say. Didn't know anyone who had a job. Nobody's parents had a job or anything like that. Unemployment in Glasgow then was 15%, and it had doubled in the last 10 years. So for most kids like me, the only thing that actually mattered when you left school was to get a job, not a career. You know, nothing else mattered. Nothing, you know, further education, higher education was never on the cards. Any job would do. The beginning of my story is very typical of a lot of chefs. And in education at school, I was hopeless. I'll be honest, I didn't even try. I was the worst in my class at absolutely everything. I was never disruptive. I was never a bad student. I was just kind of lost. You know, class sizes of 30. I don't think the whole time I was at school I ever handed anything in. And, you know, I never finished a bit of work. I was as disengaged with education as you could ever be. Saving grace for me was I was brilliant at home economics. In fact, I was the best in the school. And for someone that was the worst at everything, to be the best at something was incredible. And I found it really easy. So I took what I'd learned at school and I took it home and started messing about with food. And I would say the sort of first person that really made a big impact in my life was my home economics teacher at Knightswood Secondary. And she said to me that, because she wouldn't have known that I was rubbish at everything else. She would have just been quite keen, quite happy that I was good in her class. But she mentioned to me about being a chef. And I was probably only about 12 or 13. And I know it sounds bonkers, but I didn't even know that a chef was a job. You know, I'd never set foot in a restaurant in my life. There was no chefs on TV. You know, there was no one to inspire you into that career. You know, home economics back then was to teach you. I mean, I was the only boy in the class. It was to teach you about how to run a home. But I learned how to sew. I can work a sewing machine and all of that. So I'm quite domesticated. But it was never really considered as a job. The only hotels in Glasgow, the only restaurants in Glasgow at the time were in hotels. And again, you never ever set foot in a hotel. But I remember walking home from school that day, thinking about what Miss Drummond had said to me. And the thought of someone paying me to cook, I just thought was unbelievable. You know, that someone would pay me to do something that I loved. I was coming to the end of fourth year and I was 15 and I was ready to make my way into the world of work. My big brother was working in as a maintenance man in a timeshare country house hotel out in Kinlochard in the Trossachs. And I asked him if I could get a job washing dishes so that I could see how a kitchen was run and would maybe give me a step into being a chef. So a few days later, my brother called and said that he couldn't get me a job as a kitchen porter, but they would take us on as a commie. And within days, I was off the street corners in Knightswood and I'd moved away from home and I was in Chef's Whites, in one of the most beautiful places on earth. I was flung in straight at the deep end. Day two, I remember skinning a red deer that was twice my size, spread over two sinks. You know, a couple of weeks in, I was in one of the offsite bistros in the kitchen on my own. And again, I couldn't cook. You know, so anytime a steak came on, I would have to get the manager to double check, you know, what the degree of cookery was on the steak, because I didn't know what rare was, or medium well, or rare, or anything like that. I spent an incredible season there at Forest Hills Hotel, and I was really proud, and really proud to have got that start. I was supposed to go back to school. I was a Christmas leaver. My birthday's not till October, which meant I had to stay on until Christmas. I'm not sure if they still do that. I'd kind of decided there was no point. You know, I'd missed all my exams and the reality was I wasn't going to pass any anyway because I didn't do any work. So I decided to fill my time going to college. So I went to my local college at the time was Annie's Land and I signed up to every cookery course they had so that it avoided me going back to school. I also signed up for a welding course and a car mechanics course, which I thoroughly enjoyed. But at this time, I wanted to cook. I wanted to get a job. And again, bearing in mind, there wasn't a lot of jobs going about, but I'd seen a job for a commie chef in the paper for the Bank Pub in Queen Street. I don't know if anybody remembers it. So this is like 1987. So the morning of the interview, I actually managed to slip on the road and a taxi ran over me. So I didn't get hurt, but I was under this taxi and I was covered in, you know, all the muck that comes off the street, skinned my hands and my knees. So I tried to clean myself up the best I could. And I headed for the interview looking terrible. As I walked past the pub, there was 20 young lads queued up outside looking for the same job as me. My heart absolutely sank. I was a complete mess. I was only 15. I thought I had no chance. So I managed to talk my way in and I got the job. And I made my start the following week. From the first day that I knew that the pub game wasn't for me, after getting the experience of working with amazing chefs and produce at Forest Hills, I knew making lasagna and curry from a jar wasn't for me. And if I had any chance to have a decent career in hospitality, I knew I would have to get out. The mission was clear. I had to find another job and find it fast. I was fortunate enough to have another stroke of luck. I was talking to my Aunt Janet about my job and how miserable I was. And she said she had a friend who worked in the reception desk of one of the best hotels in Glasgow, the Holiday Inn. She would see if she could put in a good word with the chef to see if there was any positions. Within a few days, I was in the office of executive chef Pierre Girard. And again, I managed to talk my way into the best hotel in Glasgow. I managed to get out of the pub just after 10 weeks and started working with a brigade of over 40 chefs from all over the world, working with the most incredible food deliveries, you know, food in from Paris almost every day, most of which was from Scotland in the first place, but that's a different story. Could probably be another chat on that. I absolutely love working there. It was an incredible experience that started the foundations of my career and my network. This was 1988 and I was about 16. I always remember wanting to be the best I could. I always wanted to be better, faster, quicker than any of the other commies in the team. And I felt that I had to push to be better than the chefs the next grade up, chef departments. Push. That was all that was in my head. I pushed myself forward for loads of jobs that commies would never do. My first big moment was running a breakfast shift for the busiest breakfast of the year with 600 people to cater for on my own. It was the 1st of January in 1989. No one wanted to do New Year's breakfast. I did, simply because it was the biggest and hardest shift of the year. I had something to prove. My job was amazing. It was the first time in my life where I could meet the rich and famous. I was working on the buffet and was out in the dining room carving and spending a lot of time talking to customers and realizing that their success was down to working hard, but in essence, they were the exact same as me. I remember talking to this young, long-haired American lad for about 20 minutes, showing off my newly acquired buffet skills and making sure that he was getting well attended to and get everything they needed. And I went back into the kitchen and everybody was really excited and wanting to know what this American lad was like. I was none the wiser. It was John Bon Jovi. After taking advice from an incredible chef I worked with at the hall, then Ross Baxter, who's now a chef lecturer himself, encouraged me to enroll at college. And I was lucky enough to get a place at the Glasgow College of Food Technology, which is which was one of the colleges that became City. I got a part-time City and Guilds course called 7061. It was a twilight class, two nights a week from 2 till 9, and I did it on my days off. Another momentous moment there, apart from meeting my wife, I met my wife the very first day at college, and we've been together ever since. Going to college was a decision that would change my whole life. And I also met one of the most influential people in my whole career, my teacher, mentor, coach, boss, and friend, the legend that is Willie McCurrock, OBE. He ran the professional cookery department for 40 years at City. And he retired a couple of years ago, but his DNA will be in the building for 50 years to come. He's been a real rock throughout my career in almost every aspect. He's been there for 35 years. I stayed at college and did everything I could two nights a week. It took me 8 years to get to the end of my courses and I got to 7063. I fell in love with education and I simply didn't leave. I was also lucky to have a chance at the hotel's fine dining restaurant called L'Académie. It was a very traditional French restaurant. The whole service was ran in French. All the shouting, the tickets, the menu, everything. And for me to be in there struggling with English, never mind French, was tough. I managed to learn enough to survive. And it wasn't until years later that I was thinking that every single person in that kitchen shouting French at each other was from Glasgow. There was never any reason to be talking French. Kind of mad how things work. So during the last 6 months of my time at the Holiday Inn, I worked my nights and days off in one of Scotland's finest restaurants for free, known in the trade as a stage. So it's how you learn from the very best without having to spend 2 years, chopping onions. The restaurant was called October, and it was owned and run by an incredible chef called Ferrier Richardson. He was a captain of the Scottish Culinary Olympic team, and he was in the middle of everything that was happening in Scottish fine dining. I spent 2 years in the Holiday Inn and loved every second of it, but felt I had to move on and learn something new and challenge myself more. A full-time paid position came up in October and I took it. This was 1990 and I was in my second year of college. I was back at the bottom rung. I doubled my hours and half my money. The reality was the money didn't matter. In fact, I was getting a wage at all from Scotland's best restaurant. It was enough for me. I could never have been prouder. This was another life-changing move. I'd moved up at several levels in the food world and struggled to survive. The pressure was unbelievable. Surviving hour by hour took everything I had. The pressure of not letting the team down was immense. I was working 15 hours a day, working through breaks, split shifts, just to keep up. I was 6 months into my job and it was Hugman A, and Ferrier asked me to come into the office at the end of service. And with it being the last day of the year, in January and February, and restaurants are normally really quiet, I was sure I was getting sacked. I went into the office and shut the door and sat down. Ferrier stood up and presented me with a new chef's jacket with my name on it. And more importantly, it had Restaurant October on it. I knew from this moment I survived. It still chokes me up that. My time at October was incredible. I learned loads about food, but more importantly, I learned about work ethic and the importance of working hard. This has never left me. And I keep in touch with Ferrer and a lot of the team, and they're all still working hard and doing well. My time at October ended strangely, as I didn't leave, but everyone else did. Ferrier was offered the job of opening executive chef of Glasgow Hilton, and he accepted. The whole team left, and I was to follow a few weeks later once the new owner of October had got new staff in. The truth was, I had done a few years of hotel work, and I wasn't in any rush to get back to it. This took me to my first head chef job. I became the head chef of October Restaurant, Glasgow's best restaurant. I was 20 years old. I ran it for 6 months with one other chef, and after the 6 months was up, we revamped it into what was probably Glasgow's first gastropub called 55 BC. It would be the first of many openings over the years. During this time, the restaurant won loads of awards and recognition, and it was also a time when I started entering competitions. I've always felt that if you were going to do comps, it's vital to aim high. So entering the biggest competition that you can is vital. So I entered the biggest competition for young chefs in the UK, which was the Restaurateurs Association Young Chef of the Year. I reached the finals in 94, 95 and 96, and coming up against a very soon to be famous Marcus Waring in 95, who beat everybody and became Young Chef of the Year. I felt being involved in national comp was better than winning a local comp. And at the time, 55 was an incredible experience. I had to learn a whole host of new skills like man management and keeping on top of staff that were older than my parents. At 21, I was the youngest in the team. Cooking was easy. Dealing with the financial responsibility and the staff was a whole new world. But I had discovered new skills, people skills. I had a knack of getting the very best out of people, and people wanted to work for and with me. I transferred these skills in opening a sister restaurant. I was now running two restaurants, and I was just in my fifth year at college. I got a real buzz from the challenge. I was 3 years into my stint at 55, and I was approached by Glasgow Museums to launch the Gallery of Modern Art and the newly refurbished Borough Collection. The decision to move from 55 BC was a tough one, but I moved. Working with Glasgow City was a real change for me. Working with staff that had a different mindset, writing rotas that only gave people 30 hours a week was strange. This was the first time I'd ever heard the words work-life balance. I made a choice at that point that I wouldn't work 38 hours, that I would work the hours I'd always done. For some reason, I felt working less would affect my long-term plans. And the reality is most probably my ego. I remember my boss coming to see me and telling me that I had to put in for overtime. I never did. I felt a chef should be working long hours. Strange, but true. But this was another job I loved. It varied each week, and we successfully opened both sites in the evening with running restaurants in the galleries at night. Getting reviews and national broadsheets was incredible, especially for a visitor attraction run by a local council. I learned large volume catering. I had to learn it fast as I was asked to be part of the senior team in charge of one of the opening events for Glasgow's Armadillo with Natalie Cole headlining. It was 2,500 people, and they wanted everyone to have two main courses, both salmon and beef. This was my biggest function before that was for 30, so it took a massive leap. But again, I just loved the challenge of that. I continued to do some amazing events with Glasgow Museums, including many heads of state visits. I was in the official lineup to meet the Queen and Prince of Edinburgh on the opening of GOMA. And I managed a little tit for tat with Prince Philip that the press picked up on. But again, it was all in good fun. He was an incredible human being. I stayed for 2 years at the museums. And again, a job I love, but I wanted to get back into fine dining. And the truth is, my father-in-law never forgave me for leaving such a good, stable job until the day he died. He was a council worker his whole life. But the truth is, I cracked it. The challenge was done. I achieved all my goals. It was time to move on. I was then back working with my old chef, Ferrier, and he was expanding his new restaurant, Yes, to include a Northern Italian cafe. I loved the concept and the honesty of the food. Healthy food and a great environment was coming through. I took my inspiration from the River Cafe in London. In fact, I took most of their menu as well, and had to hide when the owners, Ruth and Rose Rogers, came in. but that's, again, another story. It was an open kitchen, and it was like putting on a show every day. It was great fun. But alas, history repeated itself once again. After a year, Ferrier left and took most of the team with him to a new restaurant across the road. Once again, I stayed and took up the reins of both restaurants, the fine dining downstairs and the Northern Italian cafe upstairs. It was a real challenge for me as I was running this modern, healthy, fresh concept upstairs and having to go downstairs and cook food that I thought was dated and three times the price. Wasn't great. I thought the cheaper option provided better food upstairs. And as it happens, so did the customers. The restaurant went into administration and I was made redundant. This was my first sort of real blow, getting made redundant. You know, you go through a whole load of different emotions when that happens. Your confidence gets knocked. It was a difficult time. My first call was to my mentor and teacher, Willie McCurrock, to see if he knew of any jobs that were in Glasgow, because normally they come via the college first. But he said he could offer me a day's work. One of his lecturers was at the dentist, and if I could cover a Wednesday class, you know, that would be really helpful to him. So I went in and covered that class. I went in the college at 8 a.m. And the reality is that was the first time I'd ever set foot in the college during the day, because I was always a 2 to 9 student, and it was terrifying to see the amount of students were there. I'd never seen it before. I did my class and I loved it, and I was asked back the following week. In fact, I was asked back for the next 13 years. So I covered the Wednesday class for 13 years. A few weeks into teaching, I was still on the hunt for a job. I was 29, looking towards 30, and virtually unemployed. A real scary time. I had 2 small kids and 1 in the way. I'd gone for a few jobs, but there wasn't much out there. I didn't want to make a bad move just to get cash. And one day leaving college, a relatively small restaurant group had set up a recruitment open day in the college lobby. I was on my way out the door and was lucky to have a CV in my bag. I dropped it off at the desk and explained that I knew it was a student recruitment day, but if they could pass it to someone. By the time I got home, I had an email. The company was the G1 Group, and I'd managed to wangle my way in as the executive chef. The company had 3 food units when I started, and when I left 7 years later, they had over 40. This was a fantastic time in my career. I had a job where I could think up a restaurant concept, and 6 months later, it was real. It was there. I was standing in it. I was now running Scotland's biggest hospitality group. I had 400 staff and businesses all over the country to be responsible for. My people skills, management and business skills came to fruition, and most importantly, my work ethic. One of my proudest moments was not the restaurants or hotels I opened, but I developed an apprenticeship program that targeted disadvantaged school leavers. I offered them a great way into the industry. I interviewed them in groups. I sorted them with uniforms. I sorted them with knives. I gave them 30 hours a week and no more over 4 days. And they got a day at college so they could get qualified. I recruited 80 young people, and they are now the backbone of the food scene in Glasgow today. A really, really, really proud moment. Probably my biggest achievement out with college. Another proud moment was starting the Prince's Trust Get Into Cooking program. I ran it at G1 until we took it to City, and it stayed there for about 15 years. Another proud achievement. Again, time for a change. The senior team at G1 was starting to move on, and I felt it was my time to move. Again, I moved on from a job I loved because I needed the challenge. I moved away from Glasgow for the first time since I was 15 and went to be executive chef of a brilliant company called Buzzworks in Ayrshire. They were a family-owned restaurant group and with huge ambitions. And I felt with my experience, I could bring a bit of structure and training to the kitchens. Buzzworks is probably the toughest job I've ever had, both physically and mentally. I was you know, driving 15 hours a week just to get to work. Most days doing 15 hours. Some restaurants were doing over 1,000 covers per day. I was in a suit during the day and running kitchens at night. My 2 years at Buzzworks, I helped open 4 new restaurants. Next in my career, I set up my own company. I went into consultancy. I had a company called Maclean's Fresh Ideas, And the plan was to help struggling restaurants improve standards and profit. And in financial terms for me, it was the most successful I've ever been, but I was miserable. I missed being part of the team. And the reality is I couldn't fix the main problem of these failing restaurants. The problem was the owners. I was in my 13th year covering my Wednesday class at City, and it was my saving grace. It was the only thing that kept me sane for that whole year. Then a job came up, a full-time lecturer's job, professional cookery came up, and I applied, and I was very lucky to get the job. I was told afterwards it was very tight on the academic point system, but I was lucky to get in. So there I was in the job of my dreams. I'd taken a huge wage reduction to teach, so I had to find other work to supplement my wages. So I worked in a number of places, cooked schools, ran friends' restaurants. I did this for years, working 6 days a week and 5 nights. Almost instantly when I started teaching, I was asked to get my teaching qualifications. And this is a request I was dreading. Having to go to university, it was terrifying. So I enrolled at Dundee and started my teacher's qualifications. And I thought this might be a quick end to my teaching career, because I thought I didn't have the skills to get through a university course. And to my surprise, I was like a duck to water. I absolutely loved it. I loved every aspect of it, the study, the essays, the feedback, the challenge. I absolutely loved it. I've never been prouder when I went to graduation with my kids and got to wear my robes and show my family what I'd accomplished. Also at the start of my college career, I started the City culinary team. And the college had not entered anything for years. They were a wee bit disillusioned by the competition circuit. But I thought, I'm fresh-faced, I will give it a go. So I thought it'd be a good thing for the college to get involved. And almost instantly, we were successful. And in the 6 years I ran the team, we had won almost every major college competition in the UK. The City of Glasgow College was the best culinary team in the UK. And we also started doing some international competitions in the USA and India, doing really well. Over my 6 years of running the team, we won 19 national and international titles, taking students to some of the most incredible places like Buckingham Palace and some of the top hotels and colleges around the world. We were also the first country in Europe to win the Nations Cup. Nations Cup's a biannual international competition held in Michigan, USA. And we were the first country to win it twice when we went back in 2015 to defend our 2013 title, and we won again. The same ethos was carried into our World Skills activity and helping the City of Glasgow College keep its number one status in the UK for years. When we compete at the Skills Show in Birmingham, we put in 6 students, and most times we come away with 5 out of 6 of those medals. During my first few years teaching, I won a number of educational awards as well. So Educator of the Year for Scotland and Chef Educator for the UK. This rather nicely brings me into MasterChef Adventure. We got a wee taste of that at the start. MasterChef Professionals, we use it in college as a teaching tool. It's a fantastic teaching tool for lecturers all over the UK, because the first half of the episodes have a couple of skills tests that are billed as basic culinary tasks that chefs should know. So things like fish filleting, butchery, pastry work, that sort of thing. And then they build the chef up. You know, they do the hero shots and they're standing outside their 17th century manor houses with all their awards. And the reality is the chefs 9 times out of 10 mess the skills test up. So the following morning, it becomes a great talking point with the students. You know, they come in and they say, oh, I can't believe, you know, that chef couldn't, you know, butcher a chicken or a bit of lamb. So as a lecturer, it gives us a great opportunity to reinforce the importance of getting qualified and trained properly. It's the foundations of their whole career, as it was for me. So with our success in culinary competitions, I was getting pushed more and more by the students to enter MasterChef. So I did. So I filled in the 10-page application. I sent it away. I got about 5 interviews over the phone, and then I was invited through to Edinburgh for a screen test. I had the most amazing interview at the screen test, and they told us, we'll get back in touch. They never, ever did. So the following year, I thought, I reflected on my application and how I went, and I thought I was too smart. I was too lecturey. So I went with a nice suit on, I put a tie and I polished my shoes. So the following year, I went with a pair of trainers, a Star Wars t-shirt and a pair of denims, and I thought, I'll go. So I got to the same stage, the screen test in Edinburgh, different people I met this time, and it was a horrible, horrible interview. And I came out and I phoned my wife. I says, I think I've got through. She says, how's that? I says, I think they'll put me through as cannon fodder. I was terrible. But again, they never applied. So that was me. I'd kind of done it twice. I thought, they don't like me. I'm not going to apply again. And I remember being in class and one of my students has said, Chef, are you going to apply for MasterChef again this year? And I says, look, I'm not. And he just so happened to mention, he says, today's the last day. And I says, right. So I sent everyone off on a break and I sent through the year before's application, just changed the dates. And lo and behold, I went through and got to the screen test again and managed to get through. I suppose the rest is history, as they say. But my main objective was for MasterChef. I wasn't there to win it. You know, much as I'd been competitive and done loads of competitions and had that kind of winning mentality, I'd never thought for a second that I would win it, as you could probably see with my face on that last video. My main objective was not to look daft on telly. I knew my kids were going to be watching. I knew my mum, my wife, everybody was going to be watching it. But it was a huge risk. But not only for me, it was also a huge risk for the college. And if I'd gone out in the first round, it would have been difficult to go back in class. I mean, I got slagged off for winning it. Imagine what it would have been like if I get put out in the first round. So there'd have been no escape. And now that it's repeated on Netflix and beamed to 100 different countries, you just couldn't hide for it. And in my skills test, which I was dreading the most, I got my favourite cut of lamb. But Greg couldn't eat it because it was undercooked for him. And all he did through, you know, 10 minutes of the show was bad like a sheep. And all I had in the back of my head was the students in the corridors at City copying Greg. But luckily that didn't make the show. So probably one of the most momentous moments, I think, for me on the show was getting to Final 12. And for me, it was because I got to Final 12, we're all in the same room. I remember standing there looking around the room thinking, you know, I've made it. Even if I go home today, I can say to the students, at least I've met the winner of MasterChef. I competed against the winner. And I was standing there quite chuffed and Greg came over and he said to me, he says, Gary, you know the stand-up this year is rubbish, don't you? I says, Greg, how's that? He says, you're still here. And I kind of thought to myself, well, he must think I'm good. If he wouldn't have said that to me otherwise. And the more I got to know Greg, and I've got to know him really well since, he did mean it. He's just one of those types of people. But I think, again, one of the sort of the big turning points in the show from a viewer's point of view was when I cooked in a 3 Michelin star restaurant in Oslo. And again, I think everyone that didn't know me sort of saw me as a college lecturer. I don't think they see the background and the experience and the competitions and the, you know, the 30-odd years experience I had behind it. They just sort of pigeonhole you. And that's how they kind of characterise you on the show. But as I say, when I came back, I won MasterChef on the Friday and the college started back on the Monday. So I was straight back into class and no one could know. And I told you about getting a hold of Paul. From then, life's been an absolute roller coaster. And I'm really proud of what I've achieved. I'm really proud of what's come out of it. You know, I've been able to help dozens and dozens of charities, helping to raise hundreds of thousands of pounds. I've been lucky to represent the college and Scotland in loads of events around the world, from Cuba, Colombia, all over the US, India, Singapore, to name a few. Managed to get a book out, which was expertly plugged by Paul. Unfortunately, there's none left on the planet. So if you find one, I'll buy it off you. I've also contributed to about half a dozen charity books over the last couple of years. And hot off the press, keep it between us, but I received confirmation today that I've got a deal for a second book. So that's some good news today. I've done loads and loads on TV. I presented Landlord for a wee bit. I had my own show with the BBC and obviously been asked to be Scotland's first national chef. You know, it's just unbelievable even saying it now. I mean, it's an historic achievement. Lockdown's been incredible. I've been obsessed by keeping busy, using digital tools. I've been lucky that my daughter just graduated from City doing TV and films. So I've been really lucky to be able to work with my daughter. And as I say, interaction around the world, doing classes. has been incredible. I did a cook-along to help promote Scottish food in Miami, and we made up a menu and a recipe, and 10 supermarkets in Texas made up a sort of package you could buy to cook along. And I kind of thought maybe we'd get a couple of dozen people signing up. We got 2,500 people signed up, and I cooked along with 2,500 people on Zoom via Texas from my house. I've done, you know, classes for 1,000 people in Asia. I've also done loads and loads of work all over the world with all the, the societies in the US, working with SDI and the government, QMS and Zero Waste Scotland. But the future, which is still looking forward to. I think many people thought when I won MasterChef that I would run off for the big payday, you know, run and take a job with a big restaurant group or maybe even open my own. But not many people knew my backstory, that I'd been there and I'd done that. And the truth is, they didn't know where I worked. You know, I used to say to people, you don't know where I work, so why would you say I was leaving? I work in the best college campus in the world with a principal and a management team that has more ambition for the future of education than all the entrepreneurs I've worked with my whole career combined. And I truly feel my journey is just beginning. I have a lot more to prove. And I just want to finish by giving you my official BBC quote that was on the press release the morning after I won MasterChef. Hopefully taking part has shown that if I can still chase my dreams, I can inspire students to start chasing theirs. And that's what my life's about. So guys, thanks for listening.
Gary, thank you very much indeed for that hugely instructive career that you've had. And I just wanted to say to the people listening, if you do want to ask any questions, would you please use the Q&A button on the bottom of your screen, and I will take care of that. You can also use the chat button as well. I'll keep a watch out for what's coming in. Could I ask a question, Gary, just yes, as a start off, to give people time to maybe put their questions in writing? You mentioned two or three times about taking risks and pushing yourself forward, but you also underpinned it with you felt the need to get your education in line with that as well. What would you say to young people now who are considering college or university, or in fact, we may have students in the audience who are members of the college?
Yeah.
What should they be doing in this quite fast-moving environment?
I think the most important thing, any advice I can ever give anyone, is follow your heart. You need to get out of bed in the morning and enjoy what you do, whatever that is. You know, and we get a lot of students, we get a lot of academic students that are coming back in their 30s, you know, and the story is the same every time. I've seen it loads and loads of times where something dramatic will happen in someone's life, and it's maybe a parent losing a parent or getting a divorce, and they make a point and saying, you know what, my life's mine, and I've always wanted to do something with food. And, you know, college is an amazing place for getting that new start. And I think obviously we're looking at unprecedented times. We're looking at whole industries changing, you know. And for me, I think it's a really exciting time for the hospitality industry. You know, there's young people that are looking at their life could potentially, their job could be from their bedroom for years and years and years. And I think there's a great opportunity that hospitality offers that can get them in amongst people to get that, to also not also have a job, but also have a career and a lifestyle that goes with it. So I think we've got a great opportunity. You know, the world's changing fast, and the digital world's here for forever. But I think it's a great time to reskill and follow your heart and what you do. As I said in my chat, I woke up, I had my own business. I was making more money than I'd ever done in my life. Wife was happy. I was miserable. I hated it. I just didn't like what I was doing, you know, and albeit I was successful, but success doesn't, it didn't make me happy. Financial gain didn't make me happy. And that was, I think that's an important lesson as well. And throughout the years, probably for the first 20 years of my career, I never made any money. You know, everything was always, it was always a struggle. You were always building your foundations. You were always making yourself more employable. And you know, again, that's another thing for young people, is not to chase money, work in good places, work with nice people.
Thanks, Gary. Okay, I've got some questions coming in now, and predictably, they're mainly about cooking and et cetera, et cetera. So this is going to be easy stuff for you to answer. So let me just take them, the most relevant ones. So first of all, from Sheena Crichton, apart from Scotland, where has been the most inspirational country's cuisine, in your opinion?
Oh, wow. For me, it's you know, looking at quality, is Italy. I found, again, I was first time in Italy. I worked in, I was lucky enough to do some work in Italy at the British consulate in Milan, and I did some food tours and stuff. And as a young chef, we're all trained French. We're all trained the French culinary arts, and we still do. The fundamental basics of European cuisine is French. But I remember being a young chef, and I used to write menus, then I used to fight suppliers to go find me the food. And I went to Italy, and I was there, and you'd get to one restaurant and it'd be the same food as the next or the last one you were at, because they were working seasonally. So basically what they did was they got the food, then wrote the menu, whereas I'd always wrote the menu, then tried to find the food. So let the food do the talking, the quality of the food do the talking, and keeping it simple. And from a food point of view, I think that's been the most inspirational place. I've been lucky to have done a lot of traveling. The one place that I didn't spend a lot of time in, but it just melted my heart, was Cuba. I just thought there was just something really, really special about Cuba. I spent about 4 or 5 days doing a couple of events at the British consulate in Havana. And there's not a lot of food, and there's not a lot of anything, but there was a lot of heart. There was a lot of lust for life. There was a lot of music. There was a lot of nice people there. So that would be that, I think. Favorite cities, New York. I know it like the back of my hand. I know it better than I know Edinburgh, which is saying something.
you made mention, Gary, of several restaurants, all great restaurants, but someone is asking, now that Karl Bruch has a Michelin star, which restaurant, in your opinion, will be next?
I would think the Gannet. I think the Gannet should be up there. They're a fantastic three Rosette restaurant, been there for almost 10 years. You know, a fantastic Glasgow institution. I was just reading there that there's a new, in fact, it was on our jobs board at the college. There's a new Spanish restaurant being opened by a Michelin-starred Spanish chef from El Bull. You know, so the scene in Glasgow has always been very vibrant. And to be honest, I don't think Glaswegians really care about twinkly stars as much as they care about great service, great food. You know, it's a different kind of vibe in Glasgow. But I think, you know, getting that one star is incredible. We've also got one of our ex-students who's just opened in the West, in Finiston. Graham Cheevers, so he's one of our alumni. He was with us, I think, for up to level 6, and he's had, everywhere he's worked, he's managed to get a Michelin star. So we've got a lot bubbling away. We're giving Edinburgh a run for their money, I think.
Okay, yeah, I think we are. On behalf of Ronnie Miles, Gary, he wants to know, when you go out to a restaurant and it's an ex-student who is the chef, do you do a Monica or a Greg and critique the meal? And do you leave a good tip at the end?
I never critique any restaurant I'm ever in, because I understand how hard it is. And I'm easily pleased. And I'll be honest, the majority of the times, obviously none of us have been out for a wee while, but the majority of times we're out because there's 7 of us. You know, we've got the family. So we're always kind of middle market. You know, half the time my dinner's getting served to me by a guy dressed in a bear suit, to be honest. But when my wife and I go out, we tend to go out for the whole night. So we tend to travel out. You know, we go to Gleneagles, or we go to Tunbury, or or Loch Green or somewhere like that. So we go for that full escape. And it's difficult. And again, if there's any MD in hospitality listening, you know, when you're working so heavily in hospitality, I'll be honest, the last thing you want to do with your night off is go back into it, even as a guest. You know, it's just getting that escape and coming home. You know, when I used to come home at night, you know, I would have beans and toast for dinner, you know, because you'd been picking away at lobster and fillet steak all day. So you need something just simple and stuff like that. But I'm incredibly proud of some of our alumni and where they go. We've got a young chef who's got his own business in Skye, Callum Montgomery. He was one of the very first students in my very first culinary team, and he will get a Michelin star. You know, he got three rosettes just recently there. He opened about a year before lockdown, so went straight in at three rosettes. So he'll certainly be on Michelin's radar and get Skye another Michelin star. His food's exceptional. I mean, he's just a different league. I think I'm really proud, and I know all the other lecturers and college staff are really proud of what he's achieved.
Yeah, good. We've got two linked COVID questions here. The first one asking, has COVID led to more people trying to sign up to train in the college? And on the same level, someone suggesting that they've heard that in different parts of the country, they are struggling to find chefs during COVID times because they get used to moving to another 9-to-5 job. Yeah. And what might that solution be?
So in answering the first question, our numbers at college right through COVID has been amazing. Retention for online learning has been incredible. We have been doing a kind of hybrid model, and I've went back into teaching. I'm back to doing 15-hour days at college. I'm doing 12-hour days at college. I've been doing two double classes on a Monday, and that's to help with that backlog. And I'm teaching first years for the first time ever as well, which has been brilliant. But all in all, the reception to the hybrid model has been fantastic. I think the big challenge is going to be in results and who's handing in the work, and we're getting to that kind of crunch point. So we're going to know really quickly how effective that's been. With regards to the chef shortage, there has always been a chef shortage. There's always been a huge chef shortage, but nothing like we've seen now. You know, there's restaurants that can't even open without staff. So for me, that's a good thing. Because what it means is we have to think about why. We have to think about why young people aren't staying in the industry. And a lot of chefs have found other employment. They're going to work for Tesco or Amazon. They maybe found completely new careers. They're working 9-to-5 and probably getting the same money. But my opinion is, and it's rather controversial, I think that the chefs have been subsidizing the customers forever. You know, in order to get the food cheaper, to get more people in, the chefs are working 60 hours a week instead of 40 for 40 hours money. And it's fine for my generation because I didn't care. I was happy to work whatever it took, 15 hours a day, every day of the week, because I was on a mission. But young people are different. They're wiser and smarter than I ever was, or anyone in my generation ever was, because they've got access to loads of information. They know how the world is run. Whereas when I was young, you only took your advice from your chef. That was the only way you got advice, the only way, and you never saw anything different. So the industry's got to change dramatically. We have to start thinking about work-life balance. We have to start thinking about training. We have to think about working conditions. But all of that comes at a price. And it's the customer. If they want that experience, they have to pay for it. When I started in my career in hospitality, dining out was a luxury. We've lost that, and it's not a luxury. It's a daily occurrence, and we need to get away from that. We need to get it back to being a luxury and charging accordingly so that everyone down the food chain can have a proper standard of life from it. And the chef shortage will always be there until we make it more attractive to join.
Thanks, Gary. I'm just moving now to the last couple of questions. The second last question is, how important is it for students cooking to use fresh food And in relation to that, what do you think about the fusion dishes, which are really popular in countries such as Australia, who specialise now in fusion dishes?
Yeah, I think from an educational point of view, it's our jobs to open up the whole industry to them. So not everyone in your class is going to be heading to London and working Michelin star. We have to think about every aspect of hospitality. And I think that's what's important. And yeah, there will be people that want to go into, you know, the highest esteems of food. But some people just want to get qualified. We're teaching staff, we're teaching chefs and hospitality that can be working in any sector. So first of all, our job is to make sure that as much of that is out there as possible. The big thing we did recently was open up the Royal Navy and talk about careers in the military and try and support that and make sure, because I personally didn't have any information on that and about those types of careers. So we investigated, we worked with the Navy, and we tried to get as much information to our students as possible, bringing people in so that was a career option for people. And it was, and in fact, my son got caught up in the whole thing, and he's away in September, so he's signed up and is away. So that was kind of unexpected, because he was supposed to be joining the RAF. But after meeting everyone at the Navy and seeing the culture and seeing their attitude towards their crews, basically, my son just fell in love with it. So, but that was kind of unexpected. With regards to the fusion, again, Australia, I think, is going to be one of these, they're going to be the next big thing. The Michelin star chef at the Balmoral has brought this type of fusion from Australia. And I've never eaten there. I don't know if anyone has, but it's just blown everybody out the water just with the combinations and stuff. It's something I've been rubbish at. I mean, I'm more confusion. And what MasterChef showed me was I was very Scottish on MasterChef, and I wasn't Scottish on purpose. Everything I cooked was Scottish. Everything I cooked was Scottish ingredients. But when you're fighting for your life, you've got to play to your strengths. And subconsciously, that was my strengths. And I even got haggis on the menu, persuaded by one of my many mentors in my career to put haggis on MasterChef. And it actually got me into the final three. So... but I wasn't trying to be overly Scottish. And I always remember saying to the guys when we were on the couch and stuff, if I don't get a job with the Scottish Tourist Board after this, I've done something wrong. So anyway, when I came off, I got so many messages on my phone that it broke. So I got 7,000 messages through LinkedIn and WhatsApp and all that sort of stuff. I got 4,000 messages to my email account at the college. And it took me 4 months to find the tourist board email asking for a chat. 4 months it took me to find it. It took me that long to get through everything. But I did reply back to every single person. Every single person that sent me a message, I personally replied back. It took me months. But that's, I just used to sit at night just saying thanks very much. I still do. I still wake up in the morning when they show MasterChef in Azerbaijan. I wake up to messages from people wishing me well. So it's a strange thing, the power of telly.
It is. The final question, Gary, is combined again. Someone has asked about what your favourite restaurant, your own personal favourite restaurant is, but someone else asked about what your own favourite three-course meal is. Oh. So could you combine those by saying what the three-course meal would be in your favourite restaurant, if wow. That makes sense.
My favourite restaurant in Glasgow is the Ox and Finch. And the reason I love it is because I don't order anything. I'm normally there with friends. I'm normally there with other chefs. And all I have to do is turn up and order what I'm drinking. And the rest just comes. And it's always amazing. My favourite place to go to as with my wife is the Strathairn in Glen Eagles. I love the history of the place. I just love looking around the room, thinking about, you know, what people have sat in this seat and stuff like that. The food's always amazing, and it's just they've got the whole package right. Food-wise, I'm a big fan of Scottish produce. Really, anything, lobsters, langoustines, venison, any of that. And I'm not big in desserts. I love making them. I absolutely love working on pastry, but I don't eat them. I must have made in my career thousands of chocolate fondants, and I've never eaten a whole one in my life. I just don't do dessert, but I do love getting out.
Good. I'm going to sneak in. There's a very, very last question. It's a really interesting one, so I want to give you some time on this. Given that there have been some successful training of prisoners in providing restaurant services, what do you think the scope of such initiatives is to improve the long-term prospects and employability of prisoners?
So again, this is something I know the college has been working on. I know my colleague Roy is very passionate about this subject. The thing is with this, you have to break the cycle. You know, you have to be able to give people a chance, and albeit they're in there for a reason. But I think there's so many barriers for a prisoner coming out, you know, things like not being able to get a bank account, therefore can't get a job. I once hired, long story short, when I was in Yes, this Canadian guy, big 6 foot Hells Angel guy, came in, and he was full of tattoos. He had the devil on his hands and everything else. A big scary guy. And I thought, he's not getting a job. He was in to wash dishes. I thought, he's not getting a job. So I sat him down and gave him the sort of courteous 4 minutes that I was going to give him. And the first thing he said to me is, "Chef, I need a chance, and I'm going to tell you my story." And he pulled out a copy of the Daily Record that he was in the front page of. And basically what happened was, he was born in Scotland, taken to Canada when he was 2, did something really bad in Canada and got put in prison for 20 years. He then came out and got deported back to Scotland, a country he'd never been in. So there was a big campaign not to let him in the country. And I liked him. And I gave him a job. I gave him a job on the dishes. And he was the angriest man I've ever met. He used to punch the bottom of the sink from the top of the sink when it was full of everything. But he listened to me. I could only put him on when he was on with me. He listened to me. And it lasted about a year before he moved on. He got another job, and he built a wee bit of a CV, and he moved on to another job. I don't know what happened to him, but I quite enjoyed meeting him and experiencing him. And it's not going to work with everybody, but if you give people a chance, you'd be surprised. And I feel like I got a chance. I got a chance at 15 finding something I loved. You just have to give it. And I've eaten in restaurants. I ate in a restaurant in Middlesbrough that was run from manager to kitchen porter, and everybody was ex-prisoner. And it was lovely. Really, really nice. Can't remember what it was called. But there's also, there's a lot of restaurants called Clink that are run by a charity, and it's all ex-prisoners that do it. In fact, I think it is prisoners that do it. I think you go into the prison and get fed, and then they've got the training, and they come out and get jobs. But I think people need a chance. Some people need a couple of chances, if truth be told, but we have to try and make it as easy as possible. And the hospitality industry is very forgiving. If they come in time and work hard, they'll do really, really well, and they'll move up that food chain really, really quick.
And that's where I came back in to say, Gary, that's partly what you were saying in your lecture about hard work and effort and results and seeking opportunity and taking risks. It's all connected, isn't it? So thank you very much indeed for that. So I'm not going to accept any more questions. Sorry, there's some more questions coming in very late. I'm not going to, because we did say that we would be finished between 7 and 7:15. Could I, on behalf of everyone, Gary, at Trades House and connected to Trades House, thank you very much for your lecture. It was most, most interesting and rewarding, and exactly as we imagined that you've got there through hard work and perseverance, but also huge skill. And the one thing that Trades House and the City of Glasgow College share is the culture of education and skill seeking. And you'll be aware of all the prizes that we're involved in through CraftX and the Apprentice Programme, et cetera, et cetera. And I just wanted to say that we want to have that grow even more. And I want to thank you also for allowing some of your catering staff to recently come down and do a walk through our dungeons in Trades House to have a look at what we have in the kitchens and just give us some general advice. That's been extremely helpful. So if they dogged off over coffee time to come and do that, please let them off. Because I know you're a very forgiving person, as you've said. So that's good. I'd also like to thank Paul Little for coming along. Paul is an exceptionally busy guy, and I know that he had about 10 hours on Zoom calls today. So thank you for coming to, at least it's a Zoom webinar. It's not a Zoom meeting, it's a Zoom webinar. As you'll be aware, to people listening, you'll be aware that we've been learning how to do this partly as we go along. And in connection to that, I want to thank Katrina Tilston for her huge efforts and encouragement. And although she said she was terrified of tonight, she wasn't as terrified as I was coming on, in case it didn't work out. So thank you to all out there who were firing advice at me as to how to run a Zoom webinar. This, as I said, is the first time that City of Glasgow College has taken part in this lecture. It is one of the premier things that we do at Trades House during the year, and we look forward to welcoming whoever's next in line next year. Let's hope we can maybe meet in physical circumstances. It would have been fabulous to use the college's fantastic presentation unit and theatre. That would have been great, but it sadly wasn't to be. And in that connection, I also want to thank the college staff on the PR side who have been tremendous in helping us with the whole evening. So full credit to you, and thank you very much indeed. Also, finally, thank everybody who's in attendance tonight. Can't see you, but I know how many of you there are, and it was a great take up for this evening. So thank you for supporting the lecture once again. And with no more to say, really, thank you all very much indeed, and have a very pleasant evening, and we'll see you soon. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.